Hey everybody. Hey fellow TIs. Hello fellow anybody in any country who is going through tyranny, not being as free as you want because of clandestine surveillance or torture or basically that. And hello YouTube. This is Kyle, aka Vulcan Wolverine, kind of surviving, trying to survive. But I wanted to make a video because I want to keep going. My attackers have been kind of a little bit harder on me with the remote neural manipulation. Thank God that I have Dave Case's CD, but lately they've been doing a bunch of directed dreams that are just so weird. I wake up just feeling awful, like my brain has just been wiped. I hope you guys out there, I hope you're doing better than me. Well, I hope you're not just bedridden. I hope you're surviving and actually able to do stuff. And I'm still gonna follow up on the direct cranial stimulation. I just really want to find the exact, like, a really good one. Because it's such an expensive buy, and I don't know if a lot of targeted individuals will be able to afford it. So I'm trying to kind of figure that out right now. But let me go ahead instead of talking about how I feel, because you guys basically know, I'm going through this every day like you guys, and it sucks. It sucks. It's depressing. I'm isolated. I feel like it's just wasting time. I thank God that I have like cool video games to play, and movies to watch, and talking to other TIs on the phone. Thank God that I have some things like that. I hope you guys out there have some of those things that keep you holding on and keep showing you that there still are good things in life. I wanted to show you all this. I wanted to show you all this webpage. I know I've showed it to y'all before. Directed Energy Professional Society. They are actually this weekend, the 15th. Wait, it's Monday. It's Monday, and they're doing a convention on the 15th through the 18th in Albuquerque, New Mexico. It's like Directed Energy Professional Society and many of their sponsors. And so this is what I wanted to show y'all. If you go to the Directed Energy Professional Society page, and then go to sponsors. It's going to give you a list, like platinum sponsors, gold sponsors, silver sponsors, bronze sponsors, and then just regular sponsors. Now, these are all these sponsors. This is a good place to find a bunch, not all, but a bunch of the manufacturers, the contractors that manufacture these weapons. The contractors that do research and development with directed energy weapons, unmanned and manned systems, and neuro weapons, and then contractors that both manufacture and do research and development. So, I want to show y'all a contractor real quick, and then I have an awesome article to go through. I don't know if y'all heard about the Wired article. There was one negative Wired article written about the Unity and Hope Conference. And I think it was kind of negative. It was basically leaning towards saying that we were mentally ill. But I found a really good Wired article that's very impartial. I think so. I skimmed it, but we're going to read it together to kind of make sure. But okay, so you see Booz Allen Hamilton on this list. Let's just go through. I'll go through all the names and just read them out. For the platinum sponsors for Directed Energy Professional Society, you got Boeing, Booz Allen Hamilton, Coherent, and that's the one that I'm gonna go to their website today. I'm gonna try and make this a beginning of the video thing or an end of the video thing that I do, so that we're get that, that I'm letting y'all know about all these contractors, either research and development contractors, or both, or manufacturers and research and development. Now, Booz Allen Hamilton does both. Booz Allen Hamilton manufactures directed energy weapon systems and works on research and development. Coherent only manufactures the weapons, and then other contractors do the research and development. So Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, Neutronics Incorporated, Raytheon. Gold sponsors are General Atomics Electromagnetic Systems, Enlight. Silver sponsors, Applied Technology Associates, Leidos, MZA Associates Corporation, the Optical Sciences Company, Schaefer Corporation, and then bronze sponsors are Applied Research Associates, Ball Aerospace, and I want to go over Ball Aerospace because that's another big one. EOIR Technologies, IPG Photonics Corporation, 2-6 Optical Systems, Optimax, L3 Brashear, LaserTel Incorporated, Radiance Technologies Incorporated, and then just the regular sponsors are Aegis Technologies, Corning, Evans Capacitor, Modern Technology Solutions, Ondax, Rotating Precision Mechanisms Incorporated, and Senior Aerospace Metal Bellows and SPIE. So this is a good page if you just want to kind of start off with, because these are some of the biggest manufacturers. These are some of the biggest manufacturers in research and development developers. Excuse me. Ooh, my jaw, like they're pulsing, they're getting pulse pain through my jaw, so it's a little bit hard to talk right now. I don't care. Screw it. Screw it. Important information right here. So these manufacturers and research and developers, these contractors, donate. They sponsor Directed Energy Professional Society because what Directed Energy Professional Society is trying to do is they're trying to normalize and get people excited about directed energy weapon systems development. You know, they're trying to kind of tell the public that it's a really good thing and it's going to help the Army and also get investors excited and also kind of be a place where I think they can set up conventions and things like that so that everybody can network to you know either invest in this stuff or people different contractors can talk to each other. I think it's basically that kind of an organization. And I'll be hitting on them more because it's kind of a place, a hub where all these contractors kind of talk to each other at conventions and stuff. But I want to go to this one, the platinum sponsor Coherent. And I want to keep going over contractors because I hear a lot of targeted individuals talking about who's doing this, and you know they go into the big picture of they go up top to the big picture. I think we really need to and that's good. Like any kind of explanation of this or you know what people think it is, it's good. It's talking about it, but this is who's carrying this out. You know, you got universities, hospitals, and then all these contractors. They're the ones actually, implanting people, and then these contractors are carrying out the research and the torture. I keep saying research and development. Maybe that's a remote neural manipulation thing. The torture to U.S. citizens and citizens around the world. Now, if you are somebody who is not an American that watches my video, say you're in the UK or Australia or something like that, and I do want people, not just in America, not just American TIs, to watch my videos. And I know that I am talking about American contractors, but all you have to do, I'm talking about the DoD, the Pentagon, DARPA, the DIA, CIA, NSA and things like that. These systems over here in America are going to be kind of the same. The military industrial complex is going to have the same kind of setup in every country. So kind of go off of what I'm saying about American contractors, and some of these American contractors may actually be working for other countries' form of the DoD, of the Department of Defense. So you might have an international contractor like Booz Allen Hamilton. I'm not sure if they are international, but there are international contractors that work for many countries' Department of Defense. So you know you can kind of get a framework of what I'm going through if you're in another country, and this is probably how it's going to be set up, because we know today that the military industrial complex, corporations that are working with the military, hand in hand are not just independent corporations anymore. These people in the corporations have clearances, and they're actually, it's military and corporations, so they're all working for this one military industrial complex. So these contractors really are military. I mean, they could be classified because they've got classifications and need to know, and they know more than some people actually in the military if they're because they are carrying out the torture of citizens around the world. But let's check it out. So this is Coherent, and they make they manufacture a lot of like high tech, advanced technology. Innovation. Let's go to innovation. See what kind of new tech they have coming out. But basically, all of these, you're going to go to their pages, and they're going to maybe talk, they're going to talk about technology that they have going, and maybe directed energy weapon systems in a general sense, or lasers, high powered lasers, high power microwaves, and things like that. They're definitely not going to say, hey, we're doing our best to experiment on human beings to advance these things. They're gonna keep talking about it as if and leave that part out. Like, we're doing research and development, we're making these weapons better and stuff like that. But as we know, people are being tortured by these weapons, and so we know that these contractors are actually doing this in the real world. They're doing it in the field, experimentation and torture. I think this is just some, these are laser products. So these look like laser products, but let me see. Maybe I can search. I have a long article to read, so I might just kind of show you all this page. Let me move my fat face over here. Let's see. We'll search for directed energy weapons. Energy. So let's see this, PowerMax USB sensors. Is it maybe sensors for directed energy weapons, for maybe unmanned directed energy weapons? Let's check it out. Did it not go there? Typed in directed energy weapons, hold on. Okay, so you see, they don't just manufacture, like a lot of these manufacturers, they're not just making the whole thing. Like, they're not just, some of them aren't just making the whole weapon, the whole platform. It's like they make displays for the remote platforms, semiconductor manufacturing, ceramic processing, doping, glass cutting and drilling, inspection. So they do, they a lot of these DoD contractors, they'll manufacture certain parts for the weapons, and then maybe another manufacturer orders those parts and then puts the whole weapon together, then out to, or if that contractor manufactures and does research or does torture on us, then they would complete the weapon there and then do the research and develop. I'm not sure exactly how it works because this is all very secretive, and what they put up front doesn't give us a lot of details on exactly the how it works, what manufacturers produce certain parts better. Raytheon probably manufactures the whole weapon, or at least the microwave part, and then you might need to get semiconductor parts from somewhere like Coherent to put them together. I'm not really sure about the details of this, but I just wanted to show y'all. I need to do. Let's look at this. Energy Max laser sensors. Energy Max sensors, Coherent Energy Max sensors enable laser pulse energy measurement over a broad range of wavelengths, repetition rates, pulse energies, and beam diameters. Superior performance characteristics such as high damage resistance and high repetition. So, okay, so I guess I just wanted to show y'all. I just want to show y'all one of those contractors, and that's a good place to go. And we need to, like, I mean, guys, we need to get on there, like, go to these contractors, see, you know, go through all the information and put together the puzzle pieces, connect the dots, and get some of this more concrete data of what's right in front of us, you know, and then connect it to, like, people like James Giordano and people actually speaking about the research and development and using it on humans. Okay, so I just wanted to show you all that. I'll probably go through some of the other ones. I'll kind of look over them a little bit more before I go through them. I didn't look at it. I was just like, okay, I'm going to pick Coherent. It's a manufacturer of this stuff. So I'll do my research and find some stuff that, you know, is better suited for my videos for next time. So I want to read this article, guys. This is actually a good article, and I know that there was a Wired article after the Unity and Hope conference, and it was kind of negative. It was like saying basically that it was leaning towards the side of us being mentally ill, but saying that the Unity and Hope conference was a good place to go. I remember reading that article a long time ago, and I kind of forgot it. But this, I skimmed through it, and it seems very positive, and it seems very, what's the word? It seems very, what's it? Impartial, balanced. It seems pretty balanced, and it's just telling the story of a targeted individual and talking about it and not really casting aspersions. So it doesn't seem so much like propaganda, where they want to make everybody think that it's mass mental illness, that it's mass hysteria or anything like that. It doesn't push the reader anyway. It just talks about it. And I think that we're going to see a lot more articles like this, so this is a really good thing. And I'm going to go ahead and read through it. Give me one second, guys. I was thinking about doing a live stream, but I'm just really tired, guys, and I have to open that other window. I've really got to figure out how to get the chat on the, you know, where I can just see it all the time. But I will do a live stream soon. I haven't made a video. I don't know. I think my last video was like a week ago. And this is the terrible thing, guys. I've gotten into this kind of mode where if I don't make a video every week, like if I go more than a week, I'm like, oh man, I'm not, I need to make, I have to make a video. I guess that's a good thing. I guess that's a good thing because I do not have a lot of motivation. I am very, very, I guess you just call it depressed, but you know, I'm making it through. I'm making it through. I'm not doing too bad. I'm not doing as bad. You know, there's some targeted individuals that are doing worse than me, and we have to keep that in mind. This is relative. So no matter how much pain you're feeling, there's probably somebody who's doing a lot worse. Some of you would argue with me and say that you're targeted the worst. So I mean, and it kind of feels like we're all targeted the worst, but okay, so this is by Lauren Yan. I think she's the same author that wrote the other one, the Wired article on the Unity and Hope conference. I'm not sure. And this is from it's from March 4th, 2018. So Mind Games: The Tortured Lives of Targeted Individuals. Okay, now I'm going to take a smoke of my electronic cigarette. Oof. Oh, gosh. But I hope you guys are doing good. I hope you're finding some peace. And then I want to show y'all something at the end of the video. I'm gonna play another Black Pill thing. I kind of want to make that every couple of videos. I'll play one of his videos. And he talks about general stuff and what's generally wrong with basically, you know, what's wrong with our culture and what happened and why things are so dangerous and corrupt. And I really like how he talks, and he's very passionate. He's very passionate about that stuff. And I want to show y'all one thing that I did, and I want you guys to do it. But let's go through this article. Hold on one second. This video is sponsored by Mountain Dew. Not Dew Weapon, just Mountain Dew. Like dew off of grass, you know. Not a dew weapon, not a directed energy weapon, but the dew, like honey dew or dew off of grass. Okay. So, mind games, the tortured lives of targeted individuals. Every morning, Liza wakes up and remembers that she's been tortured. When she looks down at her hand, she can see slightly raised bumps where she believes she's been implanted with microchips. She is certain that the chips track her every move, that her family has been programmed not to listen to her. She knows that her mind has been pushed to the limits of human endurance, the most pain you could put on a person before they die. And I think as targeted individuals, the most pain you could put on a person before they die, I think we all understand that. Because a lot of times we feel like we're gonna die, you know? Like when I guess the only time I feel that way lately, like through the last year, has been when I wake up. Like right when I wake up, I feel like I might die. But then like an hour later, I feel a little bit better, and then through the day, doesn't feel like I'm gonna die. It's very annoying. It's traumatic. V2K, you know, chatterbox all day. My brain has to do weird adaptive things that are not very good. Better than losing my mind, I'd say. You know, I've learned to adapt to the V2K and watch movies and play video games, but so better than just cracking up and losing my mind. Because the brain is not supposed to just take conversation all day from V2K while you're getting pulsed with remote neural manipulation. The targeting, the rewiring of her brain is so extreme that she can no longer even cry. This has actually happened to me too, guys. My remote neural manipulation and also the conditioning, because of my attackers, are surveilling me. And I've always been kind of a okay with my emotions guy. Like I would cry in movies and I didn't care, because like I'm super manly. I'm super manly, so I didn't care that I cried or anything. But because my attackers are surveilling me, and when I'm in a weakened state, they hit harder. They're like, okay, now it's time. He's in a weakened state. I front with them, and I don't cry as much. Plus, the remote neural manipulation is affecting that too, making me feel more burnt out inside, and not really, and having kind of not dead emotion, but flattened emotions. So I experience that. I still do cry, like if something's really sad, or really, it's just something really beautiful or something like that. But not as much as I used to. And so I feel her pain there. Liza is 56, a thin, wiry woman with elf-like ears and bright eyes, an artist who grew up in the Rocky Mountains. She worked at Microsoft for 10 years and started her own web development company with her partner before the electronic attacks, the stalking, and the surveillance began. She knew it had to be some form of technology attacking her. She'd worked in the technology industry for more than a decade. She knew what it was capable of. When she sought help, a hospital committed her to a 10-day hold in the mental ward, teaching her how to calm her racing heart without addressing the technology that Liza believed was causing it. When she was released, she found answers to her questions online. There was an encyclopedia of information, she says, a whole new vocabulary to help explain what she'd experienced. Gang stalking, brain-computer interface, psychotronics. I felt really thankful, she says. I felt like I was opening up this crack into a whole new universe. A very shitty universe that we all don't want to be in. Liza, who asked for her name to be changed, fearing retribution from the person or group behind her targeting, learned that she was one of thousands of people who identify themselves as targeted individuals, a victim of human experiments, tracked and stalked and harassed by remote electronic weapons. There were others who understood her plight, and together they could try to take action, fight back, and maybe find some relief. It was late October when my Uber slowed to a stop in the woods after dark. My driver seemed alarmed. We'd driven to the forest outside Boston, up a rocky, limited access road, with few lamps and no residences in sight. We pulled to a stop at the top of a hill with a few low cinder block buildings in the distance. It was dead quiet. Where are you going? He asked. I tried my best to explain. I was there to attend the first ever Unity and Hope conference. Okay, this is the one. So this is that article. Seems positive towards the end. Well, let's just read it. I thought I read this one. I read it so long ago, my memory's so shot. I can barely remember what I did yesterday. I know I play video games because that's what I always do. Hold on, guys. So a lot of you guys have probably read this article already, but I wanna read it because if I did read it, I forgot it. I tried my best to explain. I was there to attend the first ever Unity and Hope Conference, a weekend gathering of targeted individuals. The TIs were there to learn and organize and to be reminded that they were not alone. I'd first heard about the TI community last summer while researching an article about RFID chips, those rice grain-sized devices that can be implanted beneath the skin and used to unlock laptops and indoors. People have been implanting microchips in pets as tracking devices for years, even though the chips don't actually track locations. They serve as virtual ID tags that confirm the identity of a lost pet if it's listed in a database. Few people know as much about RFID chips as a biohacker named Amal Grafstra. On his website, I stumbled on a strange letter called "So You Think You've Been Implanted Against Your Will," which he posted in 2016. So that would be a good website to go to, Amal Grafstra. "Hello," the letter began. "You're likely here because you have a problem." Grafstra went on to list common symptoms. You hear voices or see lights. You believe you've been implanted with a chip against your will. Grafstra wanted to help. He is actually a big proponent of RFID technology. He's had a chip implanted in each hand since 2005. I wonder if he could help us to get these out, to get, because I think I have one in my, like this side, one of the teeth, and then maybe one in my colon, because my Crohn's stuff when I was little. Also had a PICC line in my chest right here, so I think they may have put one. It's one of those or all of them or two, you know what I'm saying? Because when I went to Ochsner's, I tell y'all, well, I won't go into that right now. I'll go into that another time. I may do a whole, I don't know if I want to do this. I don't know if y'all want to hear this, but I was thinking about just doing a video and going through what I can remember because my memory's going and I know I've documented some of it, but at the beginning videos, I didn't understand what was happening as much as I do now. So I'd like to go back through it and kind of add in what I think was happening. I don't know because it's so long. I might do that and not put it out, and maybe put it out in parts, like kind of document it myself. I think we should all do that. Document in some way so you don't, so you can get it out. Get out all the stuff that you went through, and it's kind of a relief. It's a big relief actually. To Grofstra, getting the chip implants was a no-brainer, and he loves to experiment with what they are capable of. Among other things, his implants allow him to unlock his car and operate a smart gun that only he can fire. But not everyone shares Grofstra's perspective. Shortly after news of his implants was published in March 2005, he got his first piece of hate mail. Since then, he's received hundreds more strange emails from death threats to questions from worried, from death threats, and I think it's separated from to questions from worried TI. I don't think the worried TIs are sending him death threats. In the beginning, and I don't know if this article was trying to do that, but if it was, then F you, article. Okay. In the beginning, when he first started hearing from people who believed they'd had chips implanted against their will, Grofstra wrote back to them. I was like, okay, this person is misinformed. It's a normal, intelligent person who maybe has the wrong idea. I tried really hard to engage. He suggested ways to verify if they really had an implant, like getting an X-ray at the doctor. But as TIs, we all know that this is a government-sponsored program from the DoD, and it's classified. So we know that some doctors will not tell the truth about those things. I would like to find a doctor who I could be sure would tell the truth, but how do you know? If you get an. So that's a tough one. He pointed out logical fallacies in their beliefs, including the technical impossibility of chip implants capable of tracking an individual. A GPS microchip would have the same energy demands and battery problems as a smartphone, but Like he's not thinking of newer implants and also microdust, which is basically chips the size of dust and things like that. They may just be GPSing. No, they're not, because the chips can actually send signals through the nervous system. So it seems like he's somebody that knows a lot about the chips out in the public, but he does not know about like what is need to know, like the more advanced technology that they're using. Or maybe he just doesn't know what chips can do, because a chip can send a signal. They can send a wavelength to that chip, and it can send a signal up to the nerve to your brain. And I think that's what most chips are used to do. They put them in places with clusters of nerves so that when they send a signal through that chip, sends a signal through the nerves to your brain, then it can send pain or visuals to your head or something or anything like that. A GPS microchip would have the same energy demands and battery problems as a smartphone. And while researchers are experimenting with implants that might help treat neurodegenerative diseases or link prosthetics to neural pathways, even the most advanced technology can't make someone hear voices or experience a different reality. And that's I guess that's his opinion. But his logical appeals rarely mattered. The people on the other end had already made up their minds. No, they didn't make up their minds. It was really happening. So this freaking article is not, it's that it's the one. Yeah, well, let's just read it. Oh gosh, I thought it had a really positive article that was kind of not biased, and I was totally wrong. I skimmed the first paragraph, and that sounded pretty good. And then I went to the bottom. The ending sounds pretty good, but let's just read through. In the weeks leading up to the Hope and Unity conference, I'd spoken to a few TIs over the phone myself, and I encountered the same certainty and desperation as Grofstra. But I'd never met a TI in person, and walking up to the buildings that first night, I was nervous. I had no idea what to expect. Oh, and I also want to add in, he's saying like a chip can't do that, blah blah blah, and have the problems of a smartphone. But a lot of this can be done without implants. They may have an implant that they send signals to, but a lot of it is from nanoparticulates and nanotechnology and those things that, your body, they're basically, sending a bidirectional stream that's at a unique frequency to your brain, and then it's lighting up that neurotechnology. So chips are kind of, and it's weird that he doesn't know that if he's such an expert, but chips are kind of obsolete. They're still working on those things. They still are trying to advance microchips, but those are very obsolete for doing this to people, for remotely hitting them with this stuff. But I'd never met a TI in person, and walking up to the buildings that first night, I was nervous. I had no idea what to expect. I said hello to a few people gathered outside and then looked for the conference's organizer in the cafeteria. It was the main meeting area, and it was warm and cheerful inside. Classic rock played from the sound system, and attendees, mostly in their 40s and 50s and mostly white, drank tea and ate brownies under fluorescent lights. They were, for the most part, friendly and talkative. A woman grew suspicious of my notebook. What's a better cover story than being a writer, she said, while another thanked me deeply for listening to her story. It wasn't often that she got to tell it without judgment or dismissal. Before I settled in for the night's program, a screening of a documentary called Monarch, the New Phoenix Program, I headed to the dorms. The venue was a nature education center, a summer camp for kids, but that evening the long hallways, orange carpet, and outdated furniture seemed somehow eerie. I set my bags down in an empty room and went back to the cafeteria, where the lights would soon dim for the showing. Over grainy archival footage, a monotone narrator explained the shadowy history of CIA programs like the original Phoenix program, an assassination and torture initiative that killed as many as 40,000 suspected Viet Cong supporters during the Vietnam War. Next, the documentary reviewed the infamous MK-Ultra program carried out by CIA operatives and psychologists during the Cold War. A true history that sounds like a horror film. Heavy doses of LSD, sleep deprivation, intensive electroshock therapy, alleged experiments on children, psychological torture. MK-Ultra and the Phoenix Project both sound like the stuff of conspiracy theories, but much of what's alleged has since been documented and confirmed. Right. The movie doesn't stop with history, though. It alleges that the secret government programs never ended. True. They are still attacking U.S. citizens through covert, powerful electronic weapons today, and the victims are the targeted individuals. True. The droning narrative and disturbing imagery made me increasingly unnerved, and I left before the film ended. Back in. She's like a journalist. She left before the film ended. It's weird. Back in my dorm room, I stayed awake late, listening to sirens and tires screeching in the distance. Because probably a lot of those targets that, went to the Unity and Hope Conference were getting noise harassment. At least a few of them, the people in the place, well, maybe all of them would have gotten noise harassment and stuff like that. And I get, so I'm going to try and have my phone at the ready from now on. Because I put tape on it, because you don't want that phone camera on. That if people, I've said this a bunch, but if you have a iPhone, cover up that camera because they can surveil through other means, but if they can put that camera, what they have from that camera together with together with the through the wall surveillance and radar surveillance, then it gives them a better, it gives them more details of your surroundings and where they're hitting you. So cover that up, but I cover mine up with tape, and so when I want to do a video, I'm like, oh, I got to take all the tape off and then put it back on. Got to get new tape and stuff like that. But I need to just do it. I just need to take the tape off because I get sirens right when I walk out. I'll get I've shown some of it on my videos, but I'll get aircraft, personal aircraft going over sometimes. And then police helicopters. When me and my dad were going to look for cars, we walked out into the parking lot and a police helicopter came straight over us. And I mean, this happens all the time. And I know you guys know, because I know it happens to y'all. In the morning, there were about 50 attendees gathered in the presentation room. The day began with a talk by Matthew Aaron, a PhD in neurobiology, who was working on an article on bioluminescent fish for Nature magazine when his targeting began. Today, Aaron works as a science consultant in Washington, D.C., and he began his talk with a disclaimer. His presentation was aimed at the general public, not the expert audience in front of him. By being targeted, you know more than a non-expert could ever hope to know, he said. He thanked the non-TIs who had shown up at the conference. That shows a degree of willingness to take this issue on and consider it, and that's a big step, Aaron said. It's a very lonely crime that we're going through. Yeah. But we do have each other. And I know that some people say, there is no TI community, and I mean, there's a lot of deceit and there's a lot of hypervigilance, so it makes it hard to think that, we're a family or that we're a community. But we gotta try as hard as we can to be a community and our fans. Sometimes people are gonna I isolate myself and don't talk to people as much as I want to, but they know, they understand, and so they'll understand if you do that. We need to try to be as much of a community and a family, not just to the people who live in our area and our targets, but also technology has given us a way to connect with each other, and we really, 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 really need to believe that we can do that we are a family. We're going through the same thing, and you need to find other TIs that you trust, that you can say, I am, I'm a brother or sister to them, or, I'm in a community with them. We really need to just try as much as we can, I know that we're a community. I talk to so many TIs that I love that I feel like part of a community. I wish they lived by me, but we got to take what we can right now. We got to take what we can and build each other up and really, but I've heard a lot of TI saying there's no community, I kind of feel sometimes like people are doing their own thing. It may just be a YouTube thing, but like all the TIs on YouTube are kind of just doing their own thing. And the Techno Crime Fighters Forum was a bunch of people gathering up and, and working together, but I feel like I'm kind of just doing my own thing. And I really like I do this stuff, and I really want other TIs who are doing YouTube videos to pick this stuff up. I'm like, come to these websites. You're making videos. Come to these websites that I'm putting out. Make some videos about them. But I don't really, people are kind of just on their own track, and that disappoints me a little bit. But because I'm always, I always talk about Dr. Horton and Romola D and what Ella's doing and Targeted Justice and Steve and Jeremiah Cohen, so we need to try as much as we can to be a family, to feel connected, because it may be the best that some of us are gonna get, you know. All right, let me stop babbling about that. I was trying to think of other people, you know, but I always talk about, you know, Shane Gibbs. I talk about him making a good video. You know, whenever I see somebody making a good video, I'll put, and I wish that we were all doing that with information from other TIs to promote each other, so that we're all, you know, getting, we're getting each other's information, we're getting on the same page, and we're also, like, I put Stop 007 in my comments because I want people to go and, you know, watch Dr. Horton. And I guess I'll go into this quickly. I love Dr. Horton. I love her. She's doing a great job. She's putting information out. I left a comment on her last video because, at the beginning of the video, she said, you know, we need less prayer. And I just want to say I just strongly disagree with that. I mean, I kind of know where she's coming from. She's an atheist. A lot of bad things have happened to her. She wants to get this done. But I also think that she maybe did not mean, okay, we need to stop praying. She meant we need to stop praying with no action. Just praying and waiting for God to take care of it while not taking any action to fix it, you know? I think that's what she meant, but I was kind of like, I wrote a comment saying, you know, telling target individuals not to pray es no bueno. And I still love Dr. Horton, and it's not an, I'm not attacking her or anything like that. I kind of know where she's coming from, and she talks, you know, she makes a lot of videos, and she's always kind of, she's talking off the top of her head while she's trying to, you know, get organized information out. So some things might come out a little bit, you know, but I think I think that she would agree that prayer is important and faith is important if it gets you moving. If it, you know, if it gives you faith, you have faith in God, you pray and you expect good things out of the universe, then you keep moving forward and you put some work and you put your elbow grease behind it and you know, then expect God to give you good results. I think she would agree with that. So I'll kind of defend her on that. I don't think she meant everybody stop praying in general. I don't think so. You know, so I just wanted to kind of say that. I disagree with what she was saying. We need more prayer. We need more faith. We need more prayer and action too. We need to pray and then take action. Pray to God that our actions and you know, the thing is, I think even, you know, even though Dr. Horton's an atheist, and I, you know, she believes in something. She, when she takes an action or she does a video, she's saying, you know, I'm gonna take this action and I'm gonna hope that it turns out for the, I'm gonna hope it gets good results. I know it'll get good results if I work hard. That's like basically putting a prayer out into the universe. Let my actions be positive. So she probably even prays and doesn't even know it. I just pray, you know, we pray, Christians pray to, you know, a God that created this universe and Jesus Christ, and then act. But everybody, even atheists, pray. They believe in something. They believe in something that they give their faith to. So everybody finds God in very different ways. So, okay, I'm just babbling about that. But we need more prayer. We need way more prayer, way more faith. I think a lot of us have some good faith. We know that something's gonna good's gonna we well. I'm working on it. I kind of slip. I'm like, oh, something good's gonna come out of this, and then I'll have times where I'm like, oh my God, we can't do this. So and we all do that. So we just gotta get back on the horse, and then I will continue reading this article because I'm babbling. Through the next hour, he detailed evidence of his own targeting and the potential technology used against him, from low-intensity microwaves from the neighbor next door to military electronic beams. His targeting began in his apartment and eventually became so bad that he ripped off sections of the drywall, spots he believed that emitted hot electric microwave energy. I don't know about that theory from Dr. Aaron. I don't know if you guys in the comment have had the same experience. Maybe leave it in the if you guys leaving comments have had that same experience. Maybe leave a comment. But I don't think they need to put anything in sheetrock to do this. I think it's on a grid system, and they can just go through walls, and they don't need any anything like that. So, but I mean, he has some evidence. It does like glow weird, and I'm just not sure about it. I'm not saying it's completely false and blah blah blah. But later, after he'd fled Vancouver, Canada, he examined the pieces under a black light. Around the spots he'd removed, he found rings of fluorescent material. The next 2 days were packed with similar dissections of targeting technology, testimonials, and action plans. A woman showed the unlikely links that popped up when she began typing code names for the CIA and MK Ultra into a local property deed website. So that must have been Yaya. That must have been Midge doing that. David Voights, a former naval officer, spoke about walking across the U.S. to raise awareness of non-consensual human experimentation. His talk moved the TIs to line up after and shake his hand in gratitude. During breaks and meals, TIs who had never met before discovered shared symptoms and compared notes and theories from who was behind their targeting: government agencies, criminal organizations, big tech companies, people in their own lives. You can almost say big tech companies and government agencies is synonymous now because of how they work together. They are not separated. It is not what's it called? Checks and balances. There's no checks and balances because they're all in collusion. Big tech companies are in collusion with the government because they're lobbying and giving them money. Then they have the DoD is the one giving contracts out to giving contracts out to the contractors who are manufacturing and researching and developing, and they have to give them military clearances to actually do these things, or it would just be a private business murdering people, which, I think they do that too. Big tech companies, people in their own lives. Two ways to detect or shield themselves against the technology. They were full of information and desperate to learn more. They were engineers and scientists and artists, former government and military employees, and some, like Liza, had driven more than 2,000 miles to attend. I don't want to say we need to do another one of these because I don't know if I would have the energy to organize one. But if we do have one, it'd be great if we have another one of these, and I would definitely try and get there. Just like, TI Day, we're making some plans. I don't know yet. I know I'll go, but I don't know how much I can organize that kind of stuff because I want to do my videos, and I'll definitely go to stuff. I'll help, call, the media or anything like that, or find out or go out there early. I'll do those things, but it's just like right now I feel like I'm too tired to get on the calls and say, hey, we're doing this. So I'm hoping that the lady I was working with is talking about that, so we're gonna see about that. Also, I'm kind of I was kind of thinking it would be, and I don't know, we've got to talk more about it, but I was thinking that it wouldn't be good to do it on TI Day. Have everybody, do activism where, in the state that they're in or states that are near them. Get everybody pumped up. We'll be pumped up on activism, and really feeling positive and good morale. And then we could do that. Maybe go all everybody who did activism on TI Day. We could do like if from 3 months from then, everybody go out and do the Washington thing. So I want to talk to the people who are kind of planning it, and see if maybe we could do something like that. So still kind of working it out, but there's going to be tons of stuff this year, guys. Even if stuff me and other people are organizing doesn't work out, there's going to be tons of things. TI Day is going to be badass. It's going to be badass. Hopefully this ends before then. I hope for that. Hope for the best, prepare for the worst. So we'll be preparing for TI Day, but hopefully before then, something happens and this does end. I still keep out hope for that. You never know what could happen. I still keep out hope that my attackers will stop doing V2K to me. I've talked to so many TIs that their V2K stopped. Like they had horrible V2K and then it kind of buffer it went away. I find that unbelievable. I mean, I find it unbelievable. I believe them. But I find it unbelievable because of my circumstance. But I'm like, hey, maybe my attackers will get tired of that or not need to do it anymore, or maybe get an order from their manager or their handler above them and turn my V2K off. That'd be great. But I'm hoping for that, for preparing for it not to stop, to get something to defend it. Okay, let me keep going. I'm really kind of getting off track today. That's kind of why I was kind of putting off making a video, because I'm scatterbrained and I'm hurting, and then you guys know how it is. It's got to do it. Got to move forward. Got to get this information out. Got to get this information out. That's my song. Okay, during breaks and meals, TIs who... Okay, did we already go through that? Okay, people in their own lives. Two ways to detect or shield themselves against the technology. They were full of information and desperate to learn more. They were engineers and scientists and artists, former government and military employees, and some, like Liza, had driven more than 2,000 miles to attend. Okay, so I already read that. So memory for Kyle is not good. It wasn't the first time Liza had traveled far to seek a solution to the targeting of individuals. In 2014, she drove from the Midwest to New York City, sleeping in her car for 2 weeks while she met with nonprofits she hoped to enlist in combating the problem. The Center for Constitutional Rights, Psychologists for Social Responsibility, and Physicians for Human Rights. She hoped that someone would help put a stop to the injustices she suffered. Nobody would take my story, she says. Nobody would touch it with a 10-foot pole. But at the conference, she and other TIs were among people who understood them, people who spoke the same language. Outside the representation room, beneath the sun and the blue sky, if I could momentarily forget that we were talking about mind control, it almost felt like it was an adult summer camp. And at the end of the third day, the TIs gathered together on a hill for a group photo. They called out, "We are the targeted individuals," on a count of three while the camera snapped. Getting a decent photo took some jostling. When the photographer directed more enthusiasm, a woman responded half in jest, "We can't. We're TIs." It's kind of funny. I hate it how, you know, these people who write these articles, like, they're not directly targeted. And they, you know, we're just normal people who are getting really hit hard with neuroweapons and directed energy weapons, some targets by chemicals. Like chemicals and toxins, and they treat us like we're like this group of idiot mental illness people who are just getting together, and it kind of helps us, like it's our fault, and we're normal people like them, like this lady writing the article. We're normal people like her, except people are attacking us, and we get this kind of attitude like, oh, isn't that cute? Even if it's not true, they're getting together. No, this is happening. Directed energy weapons are ripping apart families, torturing people. Don't treat us like little, hey, that's fun and whatever. This is you. I am you, but being attacked by directed energy weapons. People need to stop that compartmentalization of like, it's not happening to me now, because it will happen to you in the future if it keeps going. Sorry, I got a little bit snarky, so I will continue. Hold on 1 second. Really want to do a live stream on predictive programming with movies that have had, because I have a list of movies that I've seen, and even a cartoon I saw recently that had something about nanotechnology, and they could control it from a monitor. They can control the guy's body, and they made him poop his pants and pee and stuff like that. But I'm thinking the video would just immediately get taken down. I think I'd have to do 15 second intervals. Like, I think you can do 15 seconds of something, but I'd have to keep on doing 15 seconds and stopping it. So I might just, I'll just do a live stream and do it. And if they pull it off, oh well. It may have just been one of the movies that I showed on the last one. I hate wasting a video and then it being put into a place where nobody can see it. I'd rather make videos that I'm sure are going to get out there, you know. But I really want to do that one, so I probably will soon. There's some very blatant stuff in media today, as we all know. Okay. To the outside world, the TI's beliefs are implausible, ridiculous, or evidence of mental illness, in large part because technology and paranoia have a long interconnected history. In 1810, a man named James Tilly Matthews, who was confined in London's infamous Bedlam Asylum, drew a detailed illustration of a machine he called the heirloom. He believed that with it, a gang of invisible assailants were tormenting him with gases and magnetic rays. Oh my God, what a purely piece of shit propaganda plopped in there. Oh my God, that's sickening. Similar theories popped up with the advent of the telegraph and cell phones. More than 200 years later, the narrative sounds startlingly familiar. The difference today, the weapons exist. I'm gonna finish that sentence for this journal, for this journalist. No, okay, I'll read it. Today, so the difference today, prototypes of directed energy weapons actually do exist. Though none are in use, the UN banned blinding laser weapons in 1998. Oh, yeah, okay, so all these countries are following the UN, the torture protocol, the Geneva Convention? Like, what? The difference today, the directed energy weapons do exist and are being used. Though none are in use, are we seeing these contractors? Y'all saw the contractor at the beginning, they're manufacturing directed energy weapons. They're unmanned and manned systems. What is she talking about? That's a blatant lie. It's a blatant lie. That is a blatant lie right there. And sonic weapons have been around for decades. According to David Laporte, I thought this was like a positive article written after the first article, and I was so deceived. This is crap. I'll just finish it out. I mean, if some of you haven't seen this article, it is an article about us, and some, you know, they're explaining some of it, but it just has this, it has a bias. It's very biased. So, according to David Laporte, a psychology professor at the Indiana University of Pennsylvania, technology is the perfect culprit for delusional beliefs. It's ever evolving, and for many people, it's slightly beyond understanding. The earliest Google searches for the term targeted individual appeared in 2004, around the time Grostra got his first RFID chip implant. Wow, that is bull crap. I'll go ahead and disprove that. I'm going to do a video to disprove that the targeted individual term and all this coming out did not come out around the time that he got his RFID chip. None of us even gave a crap about that. And targeted individuals then were being hit so hard they probably didn't even get that news story. That he had that. That's. Oh, I'm getting very angry now. I'm getting angry. Making me angry. You don't want to see me when I'm angry. Okay. Implants and searches for the term spiked in 2013 to 2014 when Edward Snowden exposed the NSA surveillance of ordinary Americans. Wow. They're trying to correlate it with news articles. They're trying to correlate people just thinking and having the same story about being hit with microwave weapons. That is the definition of propaganda. That is the definition of bias. It's the definition of straight up lying. Straight up lying to disprove something. To disprove something that is true. This lady, I'd say she's on the take. I would say she's on the take. I would say that she is on the take. And I'd say that Wired Magazine definitely has ties to some of these corporations or contractors or the DOD. And then when they get an article like this, they find one of those people that they have in Wired. And they're like, you're writing this article. And you're going to say that it's just crazy talk. And that exists. People call me paranoid. Call me paranoid. But other TIs, me, and a lot of other people besides TIs know that mainstream media is very much controlled. Most of it. Some of it is not. Very, like 3%. Today, technology is increasingly folded into our everyday lives. Some 8.4 billion connected things will be used globally this year, most of which are vulnerable to hacking and surveillance. Early this year, a German regulatory agency labeled a blonde talking doll named My Friend Kayla an illegal espionage apparatus, recommending its destruction. The FDA recently approved the first pill that can track whether a patient has taken it. These Big Brother-esque developments are worrying even if you are not a suspicious or paranoid person. Yeah, and I was never a suspicious or paranoid person. And I'm not a suspicious or paranoid, well, yeah, I am a suspicious person now and hypervigilant person. I'm not paranoid. Because it's not paranoid, well, you can, what is it? It's not paranoia if they're really out to get you. Is that a saying? The technology doesn't just spy on them or track them, it attacks them. For the TIs, these devices are their worst fears realized. The technology doesn't just spy on them or track them, it attacks them. True. It's a true thing. A true statement of the article. Where was I? Okay. Finding others who share your beliefs creates a perfect storm, Laporte says. Okay, so this next paragraph, I'm just gonna tell y'all, this is gonna be complete and utter BS and cover up. Okay, so I just want to prepare y'all. Finding others who share your beliefs creates a perfect storm, Laporte says, a way for the beliefs to spiral. Without the internet, Laporte believes, this would never have happened. This would have never happened. He's probably right. If we didn't have the internet, the mainstream media wouldn't have, wouldn't report on it. And if the internet wasn't there, we would all the targeted individuals, unless you came upon somebody maybe by accident, you would think you were the only one experiencing it, that you were being attacked independently, and nobody would know. Well, maybe, I don't know. I mean, that's crazy. Okay, or at least it wouldn't have happened on the same scale, nor spread as quickly, nor become so deeply rooted, because it's really happening, and the internet is a blessing from God, so that we did have support, because if not, they would have just attacked us all, and then we would have had no recourse. We would all be put into mental institutions because we'd have no proof to, and we'd still have proof. I mean, I don't know. This article is making me really mad. Oh, God, I thought it was. I'm sorry, guys. Let's finish it up quick. I'm gonna stop doing so much editorializing. The New York Times estimated that there are more than 10,000 self-identified TIs. It is also what lets them meet each other. In weekly newsletters and in-person support groups, they find a community of people who listen and the knowledge that they're not alone. 10,000 self-identified TIs. I would think the number is bigger than that. One morning at the conference, I overhear a TI tell another that she was planning to get her perpetrators. What do you mean, the other woman at, oh God. I mean, I'm going to get them. Maybe not all of them, but as many as I can get, she says. Did you see that guy wandering around last night? You remember what happened with Vegas? What if he'd come in here with a gun? I would bet that that is a fake conversation. I bet you. Well, I bet you she was like. This sickens me. This article, I don't have the words to. I want to throw up on my computer now, guys. All right, let me just barrel through it. She's talking about the man with a fedora who had stood at a distance from the other TIs, muttering to himself, pacing and acting strangely last night. He turned out to have been a fellow TI, surprisingly friendly when he wasn't muttering warnings. But it is days after a gunman shot 58 strangers at a concert in Las Vegas, and the thought of it must have been hanging over everyone's minds. I feel unsettled too. When I curl up in bed that night, I think about all the unlocked doors at the conference and the unpredictability of violence. So she's scared of the TIs. I'm gonna start bleeding out of my eyes in a second. And for days after the conference, I worry. Was the woman I'd overheard planning something serious, and was I responsible for doing something to stop her? This is incredibly bad. I didn't read this because I would have remembered feeling this horrible. I heard that it was like an okay article. This is fucking horrible. Excuse my language, excuse my French. It's actually English slang. According to Laporte, there are rare but disturbing instances of paranoia that lead to violence. In 2016, a man. Why am I reading this? I should just stop reading. Let's finish it quick. In 2016, a man in Colorado who shot numerous police officers identified as a TI, but the statistical link between mental illness and violence is far lower than most people believe. I've not seen evidence that the TIs commit violence, Laporte told me. Okay. That's good. I was too nervous to confront the woman from the bathroom, unsure about how she would react. But before I left the conference, she approached me and handed me a binder that contained her full story. When I read it, I felt both sad and reassured. In her handwritten pages, there were many pleas for help and no plans for harm. Okay. Sometimes TIs asked me if I was worried about becoming targeted myself. I told them no, but I was worried about what might happen to the TIs and what they might be driven to do. Most of all, I worried that I would disappoint them, that I couldn't tell their story the way they wanted to be told. And you didn't. You did disappoint us, so. Because you're biased. You're biased and you're trying to find little needles in haystacks about somebody in 18-something that thought there was this air machine hitting him. And try and compare that with hundreds of thousands to million people around the world with the same exact story of the same exact weapons and toxins and things attacking them, and the same gang stalking system on all of them. Maybe different variations, but pretty much a similar story for all of them. That's just crazy. Like I had that psychiatrist appointment, and I kind of don't want to talk a lot about it. It was okay. You know, it was okay, and she's a good person. But I just, you know, during the appointment, I was just like, I just can't believe they're getting away with this. This is not something that we should be discussing. This is not something, and it's worse than we're just discussing if it's happening. It's like, no, everybody's just like, nope, no, no, mm-mm, no, it's not happening. Mental illness, you know, that's what the books say and everything like that. It's, you know, this shouldn't be a discussion. When people are hurting and being violently tortured, there should be investigations no matter how crazy people think it is. Because and that's why there's no investigations by the FBI or the CIA. Well, I mean, they're involved, but there are no investigations because they would find out that this is actually happening. Liza and the other TIs told me again and again that the worst part of being a TI is not having people believe you. It's one of the worst parts. Being made to look crazy was part of the targeting. While covert crimes, their stories are just that, stories. You could believe them or not. Most people don't. That's a terrible thing, Liza said. You don't really understand how dear and vital the connection to other people is until it's taken away. Okay, we're almost at the end. In the months I'd spent talking to the TIs, I witnessed how lonely it was to experience something that so few can see or acknowledge, how terrible it must be to be dismissed as crazy and delusional, no matter how hard you try to make people understand, or put about a million gazillion videos out with concrete evidence of the weapons and their uses and the contractors that are using them and the evidence that the DOD is giving out these contracts. Evidence of conventions where they talk about research and development of directed energy weapons. James Giordano talking about neuroweapon experimentation. Evidence. Months after the conference, I got an unexpected email from another TI. She was an artist who wore a hat trimmed and lined with copper to block out radio waves. She was lovely and memorable. I'd comforted her briefly at the conference when she had a fit of unhappiness. Her email was brief. She offered to talk about her experience and attached what she said was evidence of her targeting and photos of her paintings. You were very nice, she wrote, and that is rare for us to experience. She was nice, and then she stabbed us in the back. Well, it's like some good stuff and some bad stuff in it. But as long as people are talking about if this exists and comparing it to mental illness, we're not there. We're not there because this should not be a discussion about whether this exists. This should not. There's too much evidence, and we're breaking through all that this year. Breaking through all that from now on. We have broke through a lot of it, and we're going to keep on going. Because I'm strong. And you are strong. Actually, need to work out some. I broke into tears when I read it, imagining a life in which such a small kindness would be so hard to find. Liza had told me stories of her life before the targeting began. The 10 summers she spent working at hatcheries in Alaska, painting watercolors and working at her friend's general store, zooming around a little Honda that was like the closest thing to flying. She traveled overseas, seeing Israel, Turkey, Egypt. She spent years painting or making sculptures. Wow, it's a long article. She spent years painting or making sculptures and later falling in love with Microsoft. The campus with all its trees and the freedom to learn everywhere. She'd always loved learning and exploring new worlds, but the TI universe is different. It's not about who we are, but technology, she says. It changes who we are and it changes our lives. Once she loved technology, shaping and molding it, playing with data in the back end of a website. When the targeting first began, she even considered the ways the technology could do good. I've thought about that a lot too, and there are a lot of good things this technology could do. What if, for instance, the chip inside your head could teach you to speak a new language? And I mean, that's what they, like, after all, the military does whatever it wants to do with it. Eventually, I don't know how many years from now, hopefully sooner than later, the public will have access to this technology and be able to do some of those things. You know, you could have like a mentally handicapable person, you know, who wants to live independently from their parents, and they could have some kind of maybe V2K connection, or just be able to surveil them with this stuff to know that they're doing good, not turn it on all the time, to see. I mean, you could, like, people with mental illness, they could remote neural monitor them to see how their brain functions and get more. They could come up with new ways to diagnose mental illness by actually seeing how the brain works, like, you know, with remote neural monitoring. I mean, there's so many good things, but there are good things trickling out even now, but there's too much bad. It does not balance. It doesn't balance, and it's. The technology will be forever tainted, and it's not gonna produce as much good as it could, because of the means. The means are the ends. You know, this will always taint that, you know, the inventions and the research. It will always, the blood of human beings, of dead innocent human beings, you know, on this technology, it will forever curse things that come out with this. And not let it go to the heights that it could have. We would have done things right. If the military-industrial complex would do anything right. When the targeting first began, she even considered the ways the technology could do good. What if, for instance, the chip inside your head could teach you to speak a new language? But she quickly learned that it wasn't there to teach her. It was there to hurt her. It was permanent, and it would change her forever. Yeah. It's maybe not permanent, though. We're still working on that. We're working on that. We are still working on that. All right, guys. So, sorry about that. I thought that was a different article. But I guess I hadn't read it. I thought I read it, but I guess not. I guess I did not read that. Well, it was good to read. If you guys haven't, you know, if you guys haven't seen that article, there's a few good things in there. It'll get people maybe looking into it. And it was from March, so many other articles have come out about the Cuban embassy attack and the China consulate incident and things like that. And I hope there's more to come this year. A lot more. Okay, so now I'm going to play, it's just a little 5-minute video, and it's a general video. It's not about targeting, but it's from Black Pill. So I wanted to kind of end out with this.
When The Matrix was released in 1999, 2 years before 9/11, people already had a feeling that something was wrong with reality. The younger generation was just beginning to see the cracks in the rose-colored glasses worn by the baby boomers. The year 2000 was looming. Talk of Y2K convinced many that global disaster was likely imminent. It was the end of the world as we knew it, but we were supposed to feel fine. Another film this generation would find themselves connecting with that year was Fight Club.
I love Fight Club.
A film that warned of systematic feminization of men, a feminization and consumerism that originated from the baby boomers in academia and on Madison Avenue, that had spent decades methodically reducing the men in this country into hapless, inept beta males. Fight Club poked that bear that had been lulled to sleep inside the souls of many young men. Several real fight clubs even flared up all over the country as testosterone-starved men began to question the archetype of the 90s man and the logical conclusion that that road would lead to. And then, on September 11th, 2001, before the culture shift could really make any headway, the country was traumatized by by images of death and destruction on a scale never before seen on our soil. Broadcast live, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The fight or flight mechanism of our country was drowned in an endless ocean of rage and confusion, inseminated with a frenzied patriotism so intense that even some of the best among us lost the ability to distinguish the red from the blue pill. As you can see by looking around us today, many did take the blue pill. The righteous fury has now subsided, faded away, and left us only with feminized men, directionless women, and a culture in ruins. A culture built on coping mechanisms, escapism, and endless pharmaceuticals. There are still those that escape the indoctrination, that look back at these warnings, these prophetic allegories whose messages were so germane that they would be permanently burned into the modern lexicon. They look back and they long for a time that has been swallowed up forever by the appetites of the powerful and the negligence of the gluttons they have descended from. While examining the meaning of these warnings, it should not be forgotten that the most important scenes in these films weren't about the awakening itself. That was inevitable, and simply the beginning, the first act. That part of the story is coming to a close. It's what happens next that will define these new generations that have been burdened with the aftermath of their mothers and fathers' inaction, indecision, or delusion. Endless injustices for which there are very few antidotes. These young men are now grown up. The torch is being wrestled from the grip of the baby boomers. The summer of love that exists only in their increasingly senile minds has been exposed for the reckless naivete and hedonism it really was. The lack of discipline and the drug-fueled devouring and bastardization of our culture at the hands of these people may finally come to an end. The power threatened by those that have resisted the programming. But they are not the only contenders determined to shape the future. There are also legions of blue-pilled counterparts, slaves who do not wish to be freed. Or to quote The Matrix, the Matrix is a system. That system is our enemy. But when you're inside, you look around, what do you see? Businessmen, teachers, lawyers, carpenters, the very minds of the people we are trying to save. But until we do, these people are still part of that system. And that makes them our enemy. You have to understand, most of these people are not ready to be unplugged. And many of them are so inert, so hopelessly dependent on the system, they will fight to protect it. For Black Pill, I'm Devin Stack. If you like my content, make sure you like and subscribe. Click the notification bell.
I want to read one more. I want to watch one more, guys, since this is already pretty long, just one more. But I did want to show y'all, I left a comment right under his. So this was just, it was about like how, I don't see people who are instinctively trying to protect the system and don't know how bad it is. I don't really see them as enemies. You know, I see them as we need to rescue them. You know, we need to help them to see, we need to get more people that do see the corruption so that we can stand up, so that we can get that, you know, get that fire. We already have that, because we're being murdered, so we already have that fire that we need to change things. We know we need to change things. We need to get other people fired up too. And I don't really see them as enemies, but they can act like enemies sometimes. So I wanted to, why doesn't it show the whole thing? Doesn't show my whole, okay, well, let me read. So I left it, I said, Black Pill, can you do a video on targeted individuals and directed energy weapons? I'm a TI, and I've been horribly tortured and basically had MK Ultra from afar performed on me. I want you to know this is a real phenomenon, and hundreds of thousands to millions of people around the world are being remotely surveilled and tortured. The mainstream media has been mandated only to put propaganda saying that we are mentally ill out to the public. We need help from the real media, which can only be, I think, only be found in alternative media, I think I said. But this is just an example, you know, what we should be doing. And I think Future Knowledge was talking about it, and I think a lot of people already do this. But for TIs that aren't, and maybe you're like, well, I don't want to make videos, maybe, you know, go to some videos, and if you see somebody talking about corruption in society or the deep state, you know, and they have videos kind of, their channels are based around that, about giving people knowledge and awareness and waking them up, please leave a comment, something like this, so that we can, you know, there's a chance that person will see that comment, start looking into it, and then make a really good video. I think that's what happened with that redheaded YouTuber. I can't remember her name. My memory's so bad. But I think probably somebody commented to her and told her about it, and then she researched it and started doing some really good edited videos about it. I hope to... I don't know. I don't want to make any promises, but I'm trying to get into the mode where I can make some small little, you know, well-edited, like maybe 15-minute documentaries or something like that. I don't know, though. I'm going to just keep doing this. I'm going to keep doing what I have the energy to do. But I'm hoping to maybe do some of that. So that's what we should be doing. If you don't want to make videos and you don't really want to put yourself out there too much, then that's a good thing to do, to go to other videos or even just comment on, you know, targeted individuals' channels, you know, so you can get your voice heard, you know, in whatever way. Okay, so I wanna listen to one more. It's only 6 minutes, and I really love the I just like this guy's videos. I like his voice too.
It's been 50 years since Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was shot to death on a motel.
Most people will automatically conform to what they perceive as popular because their existence relies on the group. Whether out of circumstance or limited abilities, many are dependent on the group for survival. So they are biologically hardwired to go along with the group. Maybe they receive government benefits from the group, or perhaps they are a cog in a large globalist corporate machine. But most people aren't business owners themselves or independently wealthy. Without the group, they would be unable or unwilling to fend for themselves. So conforming to the group is crucial to their survival. Late night talk shows are very popular with these kinds of people because they supply instant feedback from the group. They are given audible cues that inform them of the group's position on popular topics, whether or not they should approve or disapprove of this person or that person, in the form of cheers, applause, and laughter.
And I want to remind y'all, and I think I might try and show that on one of my videos if I can remember, but I think we all remember, I don't know if all of you guys have seen it, but Stephen Colbert, whenever Donald Trump's assistant, got Kimberly something. I can't remember any names. Oh, memory. But she said, she was like talking about the president getting briefed on surveillance and how even cameras can turn into microwaves. She said it wrong. But then Stephen Colbert did this whole thing based on this, you know, a whole joke on it where he turned on the microwave and he was like talking to a camera inside of the microwave while he cooked a hot pocket, just making fun of the whole thing, you know, and the audience laughed and was like, oh yeah, that's so crazy and stuff like that. So it got them to kind of forget that what she was saying was kind of true. Microwaves can be used to see things, to surveil things. She said it in a dumb way, but what she was saying was true and people needed to look into it. And so what he did is a comedian in a late night show, talk show host, late night talk show host, you know, he told the audience, this is silly and it's crazy and haha, let's just laugh about it. She was just, you know, she just didn't know what she was talking about. So it kind of feeds into, you know, what he's talking about here.
Television studios became aware of this psychological trick and the need that the average person had to be given this group feedback before they could comfortably respond to jokes, and that led them to insert artificial laughter into most sitcoms.
It's not massive. It's just average size.
Which later evolved into cutting to reaction shots in shows that didn't have a laugh track, like NBC's The Office. It is these visual and auditory cues that communicate to people where the group stands and therefore what to conform to in order to ensure your survival within the group. This is precisely why corporate political propaganda employs these same tactics.
What we need are laws, real laws, that do everything possible to keep assault rifles out of the hands of people who are going to shoot our kids. Go on TV and tell them to do that.
Jimmy
Kimmel or John Oliver make a joke at the expense of a politician.
Donald Trump, the only president who combines the sordid extramarital affairs of a young JFK with the dead-eyed puffiness of a post-Watergate Richard Nixon.
And the audience, who they themselves are responding to visual cues in the form of applause signs, cheer with glee. It is communicating on a visceral level to those people whose survival is directly tied to being part of the group that their survival is also tied to disapproving of that politician. It programs them to have a negative response when they hear that person's name in the future, because that person is not approved by the group, and therefore, approval of that person endangers their very existence. If you doubt what I'm saying, I'll give you a perfect example of this programming. After her defeat in the 2016 presidential election, Hillary Clinton blamed James Comey for her loss.
I was on the way to winning until the combination of Jim Comey's letter on October 28th and Russian WikiLeaks.
The propaganda ministers spun into high gear and began programming their audience to dislike Comey. The programming was so effective that when Stephen Colbert announced to his audience some months later that President Trump had fired Comey, many in the audience cheered.
Huge story that broke just minutes ago, like less than 10 minutes ago. FBI Director James Comey has just been fired by Donald Trump. Wow. Huge Donald Trump fans here tonight.
This was not the correct response, and Colbert immediately rebuked them and wasted no time in communicating that the group now liked James Comey. The audience, both in the studio and at home, obediently accepted the new programming, and that programming will persist until such a time that the narrative changes, in which case the audience will be reprogrammed once again. Television has always been a tool of the elite. The astronomical costs involved in producing programs and distributing them to the public meant that all the messages contained in the programs could come only from the elite. Now, with the internet and the ease of access to platforms like YouTube, the ruling class is now losing its stranglehold on the flow of information. It is also fracturing their ability to project what group consensus is, which is important if you want to control the people that just want to conform to the group. Group consensus is now communicated through how many likes or retweets or thumbs up a post might get, or the subscriber count someone might have. This evens out the playing field and is precisely why they have begun to censor and shut down channels that go against the approved narrative. I myself have had view counts manipulated on YouTube, and channels way bigger than mine have been banned recently because they didn't go along with the official narrative. This is why it's so important that you support independent media, like whether it's black-pilled or it doesn't matter, so that the global elite,
TI
the ruling class,
videos,
or some people like
TI
to say
is
just
videos.
They
please support
don't
us.
Have a monopoly on information
like,
and influence.
Share.
I
and
will
subscribe.
Do this as long as I'm financially able to. If you see that I've stopped making videos for a while, it's because I've had to go find paying gigs, and sometimes it's cool stuff. Like I've done stuff for Milo, done stuff for Cernovich.
If you see me stopping making videos for a while, it means I'm in my Faraday bunker, shaking abnormally hard, and trying not to lose my mind. It's not funny. I'm sorry, I have to laugh or I'm gonna...
InfoWars has played some of my videos. Sometimes it's not so exciting as that. But I gotta pay the bills. But I promise you, my viewers, I will continue to fight for freedom, and most importantly, the survival of Western civilization, as long as I'm physically able to. Now, if you'd like to support me, You can send me crypto. I've got a couple addresses down below. I also have a Patreon page, which I really haven't used. I think there's literally zero patrons right now. And that's patreon.com/blackpilled. But also what's important is like and share these videos and subscribe to the channel, because it's going to deliver those social cues to the people that depend on us to survive that there really is consensus. I really hope you choose to support me.
That's why with target individual videos and all these videos telling truth and making people aware, make sure to subscribe to them and like, so that they can move up and get more people watching them. Then people will be like, oh, okay, target individuals. This video has 100,000 views. It has all likes. You know, okay, this is happening. And there's a consensus, even without the mainstream media having to tell people. I think we're still in that point in time, you know, where the biggest percentage of the population is like, it ain't true unless the mainstream media says it. Like, you know, they think that all alternative news is up for debate. Everything in alternative news is up for debate, even if you're giving straight up evidence, and that has to change. I mean, I think we're getting bigger and bigger percentages understanding that the mainstream media not talking about something doesn't mean it's not true, but still I think we got the majority still saying, hey, that doesn't exist unless the mainstream media tells us. So really, really support targeted individual videos. I mean, people that you like what they're doing. You agree with what they're saying. You know what I'm saying.
For Black Pill, I'm Devin Stack.
All right, guys. So that's it for today. I just wanted to kind of make a quick video. I guess that article was pretty long. I thought it was a different article, but I guess I needed to read that anyway. We just need to read any article where they're presenting, they're presenting targeted individuals and talking about what's going on with us. Whether it's negative, positive, or kind of negative, kind of positive, we just need. But I'm sure a lot of y'all have already seen that article. All right, so I love you guys, much more to come. I'm doing my best with trying to make a couple of videos a week. It's hard. It's hard to get up the energy, but I'm really gonna try hard, guys. So. You know, I'll be here making videos. You might, I think this week I'll be making some, but there may be some weeks where I'm, just surviving. But we'll see how it goes. I don't want to, I don't want to jinx it. So I'm gonna be trying as hard as I can to get stuff out. And all you TIs out there on YouTube and Facebook and Twitter, much love to you. I'm so proud of you and I just support you so much, and you're courageous. Every TI who's on, every real TI that's speaking out on YouTube and the conference calls and everything, much love to you. Much love to everybody. And I just hope you guys are finding some comfort. We're going to be the direct cranial stimulation, be looking more into that, more into the science of that, and trying that out. When I get mine, I'll demonstrate it. On a video, and we'll see if that's maybe something that we want to use. I'm sure some targeted individuals already use it. All right, guys, leave me a comment. I love your comments. That's what I may do. I need to do a live stream on y'all's comments, on going through some of y'all's comments and maybe answering, or just if y'all have a good comment, just reading it. I've been meaning to do that, and I keep forgetting. Everything. I'm gonna wait till it gets to 134, because I hate the number 33. Because after my 33rd birthday, a week after, like my dad, the day after, started getting the high pitch ringing at the end of a week, he had an aneurysm in his brain and almost died. So I'm gonna be waiting for that number to get to 34. Because Mason's like the number 33. Hate Masons. I think that my attackers are Masons. All right, guys, so I love y'all, and I will see you on the next one. All right, guys.